Hey, morning. How about a debrief, your quiz debrief, grade 12 applied, week 2, probability? Okay, so read and do. Standard instructions, you're expected to have a cheat sheet. For now, you can use my cheat sheet, that's fine. But adapt my cheat sheet so that your cheat sheet that you use and the reference notes that you use when you study, you know, when you're sitting in the tub or whatever. So you have to submit a cheat sheet with your final exam. And you know me, I'm always drawing graphic organizers, so use pictures and sketches to focus your thoughts. Nobody does that yet. It seems obvious to me. Pictures are way more useful than a bunch of silly words. Anyway, round decimal answers, as always, to the nearest 0.01. All right, did you tick this box? Did you get that extra mark? Did you read the instructions? Show your work. Show your work. It helps you organize your thoughts. It helps me see what you're thinking so I can give you part marks and pretend you're explaining it to your younger nephew or something, right? You're not just going to fling numbers all over the place. You're going to be slow and methodical and show him how to do it correctly. So there you go. Do it properly. So there's our cheat sheet. Well, there's my cheat sheet. You might have already started adapting it and fixing it up. We've only learned this much stuff, right? That's all we've learned in 2 weeks. We've learned like 10 centimeters of stuff in 2 weeks. So it's not like we're overdoing it here, all right? In fact, we're falling behind. So we've only learned these items here in 2 weeks. It'll be 3 weeks by the time we're done this. Crazy. Yeah, but that's kind of normal. All right, so let's do the first one here. Redo. Now, if you're just watching this movie for the first time because you missed the quiz, you know, don't miss too many quizzes. But, I'll make this a long, elaborate movie so you get the sense of how I do things. They won't always be this long and elaborate. But anyway, do this, all right? So you better not be just watching me do it for you. You better have a blank piece of paper in front of you with a pencil and a calculator, all right, and your cheat sheet. Let's do it. How many equally likely outcomes are on that spinner? Well, I can count. There's 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There, that was a gimme. Right, what's the probability I spin a green? Well, let's see. How do you calculate probability? You take the number of possibilities, so the number of possible green outcomes, divided by the total number of possible outcomes, so it's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4 greens out of a total of 8. So 4 out of 8, 1/2. We always reduce fractions. C. All right. Let's solve it using proportions. If you spin the spinner 200 times, how many times do you expect, on average, to get a green? So I like the proportion method as one way. So you say if it's 1 for every 2, then it's X for every 200. And you just pop that number up to there, right? You cross multiply. So that's called the proportion method. So you can expect, on average, usually, if you spin 200 times, you should get about 100, right? It's an expected value. It's not guaranteed. You might get 107 one time, and then the next day you might get 93, and then the next day you might get 101. So on average, every time you spin, make a 200 spins, you should, on average, usually get about 100. And if you just want to rearrange the formula instead, right? You know, the formula for probability of green, we did it up here. It's the number of green compared to the number of spins. So all you got to do is pop that number up to there. In other words, you multiply both sides by the number of spins. So it's the same relationship. It's the same formula. We just juggled it around. And you plug into the formula the probability of green times the number of spins. 1 out of 2 times 200 is 100 greens. There you go. So no matter how you do it, it works out. 100 greens you can expect. You ready for the next slide? Pause, do. Oh, these are fun. Everybody aces these. They're just kind of fun. I love these, all right? Redo. Determine the number of different routes to go from A to B. And you got this choke point here, right? All right, so let's just use the Pascal method, right? The method that Pascal came up with. No, it was Blaise Pascal. Etienne was his father. All right, anyway, he came up with this neat method. If you kind of tip this on its side and think of it as the Pascal triangle, boom, there you go. There's 15 ways to get to there. And then I could just carry on with the 15s, and then the numbers get pretty friggin' big, right? So I'm just going to start renumbering. So I'll just start renumbering from the choke point there at Q. So there's 15 ways to get to there, and this I'm just going to renumber the second part. And that's going to be another, 20 ways, all right? So if I use that fundamental counting idea, right, if there's 15 ways to get to there, and for each of those ways, there's another 20 ways to carry on, doesn't that mean there would be 300 ways? So to go from A to B, there'd be 300 total paths. Now let's calculate how many of those paths wander past point Z, right? Because maybe Z's where the post office is, and you want to actually go past the post office and pick up your check or something. So I'm not going to redo all of this. I know from there to there is 15, for God's sake. So I'm just going to redo this part of it. All right. So yeah, don't go junking up this. Just redraw it. How hard is it to draw a little 9 box like that? Come on. So sketch. Drawing graphic organizers and sketching is the secret, I'm not kidding, to math. All right, so I just redrew it. It took like 10 seconds. Now, careful now. If you're going to go from here to here, well, obviously you didn't go there or there or there or there or there. Otherwise, you would have missed point Z. So blank them out or erase them or something. Right, you are working in pencil, aren't you? All right, boom. And you can just renumber all your bits like that. 1 gets 2, 2, 1 gets 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 6, and 3 and 6 is 9. So now there's only 9 paths that go from Q to B. So we're going to take the number of ways to go from A to Q, which was 15, and we're going to multiply that by the number of ways to carry on from Q to B going via Z. And you're going to end up with, all right, so we're trying to calculate the probability of going from A to B via or through point Z. So we got to do the number of paths that pass through Z. So it's 135 out of the total of 300 if there was no restrictions or constraints. And if you reduce that on a calculator or in your head, 9/20. So 45%. Okay, so you know how to reduce fractions, I hope, right? So there's a button on your calculator, does it? Next slide. Now, there's another way to do that, which we had just learned a little after that. You could have done that distinguishable arrangements thing. Do you remember how to do the distinguishable arrangements method? Let's try that. All right. So if you want to go from A to Q, A to Q, I just gave this thing a name. It didn't have a name. I gave it one. All right. And you got to make 6 decisions. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Do I go there or there? Yes. So there's 6 decisions you got to make. Do I go east or south? But, of course, guess what? If you want to get from A to Q, exactly 4 of them have to be east, and exactly 2 of them have to be south. If you don't have 4 easts and 2 souths, you're going to miss Q. Do you remember how to do that with distinguishable arrangements? Do you remember how to do that? To do distinguishable arrangements, you take the number of decisions, the number of steps. So you pretend it's 6 letters. Somehow you got to take 4 E's and 2 S's and come up with the different ways to arrange them. So remember that was 6 factorial over 4 factorial times 2 factorial. And if you do that on a calculator, you'll find out that, oh, make sure you put brackets around this part. You'll find out it's 15 paths to get from there to there. Well, duh, that's what Pascal said too. So Q to B is going to be the same thing if we do the unrestricted one. If we do the unrestricted where we're not having to go through Z, it's going to be another six steps, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But this time, three of them have to be east and three of them have to be south. So whether you do three south and three east or then like that, it doesn't matter. No matter how you do it from there to there, you eventually end up doing three of those and three of those. So it's going to be the same idea. Distinguishable arrangements of six letters where three of them are E's and three of them are S's. And if you want to be goofy, you can do it the long way like this. But you know what? Just pull up your calculator and do that. All right. So there you go. And be careful. Make sure you put brackets in the entire denominator. That's a pretty common mistake. If you got a gaggle of numbers in a denominator doing the dividing, you better put the entire bottom in brackets. Otherwise, you're going to be dividing incorrectly. So here we go. A to B then, if you go unrestricted, using the fundamental counting is, well, 15 times 20. There you go, 30. All right, so then we could keep calculating more stuff, and it just gets funner as you go along, right? So, yeah. Anyway, you could come up with the number of ways to pass Z would be that, and then you divide it by the number of ways to go if you weren't restricted, but you had to go, and then you could do some fun stuff like that if you're really goofy doing pre-cal, and you'd still get the same answer, okay? There you go. So, yeah, that's just, I was being fun, all right? So let's do pathways. Oh, and you know what? You could have also, we just recently discussed that those arrangements of letters, when you've only got two choices, are really combos. So it turns out we might not have actually got to this part of the lessons, but it turns out you could just use the combo button on your calculator. All right, so there you go. I'll just leave you with that for now. We'll be looking at that again later. We did have a quick assignment on that. All right, let's do this. All right, so let's do some sample spaces here. Read and do. If you're waiting for me to do it for you, that would be not a good way to learn. Here we go. Did you do it yourself? All right, so you're going to make a decision. You got to decide, what type of cereal am I going to have? So it could be S, Shreddies, Fruit Loops, or Rice Krispies. And then, once you've made that decision, then you got to make another decision. So for each one of those decisions, there's two more decisions. So it would be, right, orange, apple, orange, apple, orange, apple. So there you go. So there's your tree. There's your decision tree. There's all the possible breakfasts you could have. Now, if we make a list of all the outcomes, right, if I just follow the past, you could have Shreddies and orange juice, Shreddies and apple, Fruit Loops and orange juice, etc. Those, that list of possible outcomes is called the sample space. The sample space. And notice it's got a size. Notice there's six of them. How about C? Determine the probability he has Shreddies and apple juice. So which one of those branches has Shreddies? Oh, there it is right there. Shreddies and apple juice. There's only one branch that has Shreddies and apple juice. So that'd be one out of six. So the probability is one out of six. And that's some weird percent that you'd have to round off. I don't like percents. Whether you do it as a percent or a fraction, I don't generally care. Fractions are so much more nicer usually. But then when you go to compare things, it's kind of nice to use percents. So percents have their purpose. What's the probability he has no orange juice? So go through and count all the branches that have no orange juice. Well, I see three of them. They're the ones with the apple juice. They're the complement of the apple juices. So it'd be three paths with no orange juice compared to six. So it's a 50% chance he's not going to have orange juice. So, yeah, being able to kind of picture and draw out a sample space is kind of important. Okay. Make sure you got some blank paper in front of you and a calculator. Read it. Do it. Pause this if you have to. Here we go. Mr. F has 10 students. He's got 3 coupons for Timmy's, a coffee, a sandwich coupon, and a donut. He throws everybody's name in a hat, and he's going to draw out the names, and he does not replace the names. If you throw the names back into the hat, well, then one person could win all 3 coupons. That wouldn't be fair. Or would it? All right. Let's determine the number of possible ways Mr. F can hand out the 3 coupons. So I'm going to draw a picture, right? Here's the different coupons. And here's my 10 students in this hat here. And I'm going to draw out 3 students. Can you kind of see how drawing things out kind of helps? We're going to use the Fundamantal Counting Principle, the FCP. All right, so I've got 10 students, and I've got to, there's my 10s. I got to select 3. 10 different students. There's no twins in there. 10 different students. I'm going to select 3 of them. How many choices that could randomly get the coffee? There's 10 people. All right, now I didn't put that person back in the hat, so now there's only 9 people left. So the number of ways I could hand out the sandwich is 9. It's important to remember whether we're replacing or not. So there's going to be one less choice there because I've already put one there. So that'll be a 9. And then guess what? This will be an 8. And 9 times 8 is 72 times 10 is 720. There you go. So 720 ways to, like, that the coupons could have been handed out. Now, how many ways could I hand them out if I kind of cheated as the teacher? Oh, by the way, you got a button on your calculator does that too, right? If you recognize that you've got 10 things and you're going to make an ordered arrangement of 10 different things and you're going to make an ordered arrangement of 3 of them, if you've got 10 different things and you're going to make an ordered permutation of all 3 of them, the button on your calculator does it, all right? So you do have a convenient button on your calculator. This will always work, the fundamental counting. Sometimes it gets a little annoying, though. All right, so sometimes the button comes in handy. All right, so now let's do it. But this time, for part B, now this time I've decided that Sylvan's going to get the donut coupon. So if he gets the donut coupon, well, there, it's a done deal. I'm just going to give him the coupon. All right. Which means, how many choices do I have for the coffee? Well, I've already given Sylvan his coupon there, so there's 9 times 8. So there's going to be 72 possible ways to hand out the coupons if I just already give Sylvan the donut one. So, yeah, counting is kind of fun. You got to pay attention to how to count. To do probability, to do theoretical probability especially, you have to know how to count what you want compared to what you could get. All right, let's do another one. Pause, do. Let's calculate. Let's do some permutations. All right, so here you've got 7 permute 2, or sometimes we say 7 pick 2. So the 7 there is the number of items from which we're going to select. The P means it's an ordered arrangement of different objects. And the 2 means that's how many of those 7 objects you're going to take out and set down in some order. Can you hear those words I'm using? Order, different. There you go. So put it in your calculator. One of my calculators looks like that, 7P2. Or you know what? If you didn't, some calculators don't have the NPR button on them. If you got a Dollarama one or just using your phone, all you've got is the factorial button. So then you'd have to write down the formula. The NPR is the N factorial divided by the N minus the R factorial. So you'd have to write 7P2. And if all you had was the factorial button, because that's all you had was a Dollarama calculator, right? Well, then you'd have to go like that on your Dollarama calculator, and it would tell you it's 42. All right? And if you didn't have a calculator, if you're using a really, really cheap calculator that didn't even have a factorial button on it, you could just go 7 factorial divided by 5 factorial, and then you'd say, well, all of that cancels all of that. they become 1, so you end up with 7 times 6 divided. 7 times 6 is 42. So no matter how you do it, using fundamental counting, using the NPR button on the calculator, using the factorial button on a Dollarama calculator, or the way we had to do it when I was young, we had to do it the long way, or there's tables too, right? Right, there's tables. All right, there you go. Anyway, let's go back to this one. 10P0. Now, believe it or not, now the ladies don't believe it, but there's one way to do nothing. All right, it turns out there's one way to do nothing. If I have 10 things and I want to make an ordered arrangement of none of them, it turns out that there's one way to do nothing. Right, guys understand that. Alright, so it turns out if you put 10P0 or P10 in your calculator, it comes out as 1. Whiskey Tango Hotel. What the heck, right? So you could use the formula. If you use the formula, it still works out too, right? So, yeah, that usually baffles people. But there's one way to do nothing. Doing nothing counts as one thing, especially to guys, right? Here we go. Now, in my day, of course, we didn't have calculators, certainly not calculators that had an NPR button or even an exclamation mark on it. I had to babysit for 220 hours at 50 cents an hour so I could buy a $110 calculator in 1972, and it wasn't even as good as a $3 calculator at Dollarama. Imagine babysitting 220 hours so you could buy a calculator. That was actually kind of no good. Anyway, in the old days, they would compute all these permutations one time and they'd break them down at the back of a book. And that way you didn't have to always calculate them yourself. All right, so yeah, you've got the perm tables in the back of the notes. Notice that 7 permute 2, right? If your N is 7 and your P and your R, rather, is 2, is 42. We just did that. And notice that the number of ways to do nothing is 1, right? So whether you have 3 things and you're going to select none is one way. Whether you have 10 things and you select none is one way. And there's all kinds of other interesting patterns in here. Can you see some other patterns in here? That's what math is all about, by the way. There are so many patterns in here, all right? But, yeah. That's why I like tables, because then you can see patterns and relationships. Anyway, that's at the back of your notes if you ever want to play with that. All right, explain in a grammatically correct sentence, so use proper English grammar. All right, here's what I said. You ready? Boom. So I said, probability and odds are measures of chance. Yes, probability measures the number of ways something does happen compared to the number of possible ways it could have happened. Odds is a comparison of the ways and an event could happen compared to the ways it could not happen. All right, so there we go. Let me fix that up. Boom. The probability I get lasagna. So I gave an example. Sometimes an example works nice. The probability I get lasagna for dinner tonight is 10%, which is 1 out of 10, right? So that means the odds in favor of me getting dinner is there's one chance, one way I'll get lasagna out of the 9 ways I will not get lasagna, because 1 plus 9 makes 10. And then you use odds against if I was going to bet, right? Usually you use odds against for gambling payouts. So you just flip those numbers around. It would be 9 to 1. So there's 9 likelihoods of me not getting lasagna for every 1 likelihood of me getting lasagna. Next slide. Pause, do. Bananarama. Here we go. How many ways can you rearrange all those letters to make another word? All right. How many ways can you rearrange the letters? There's 6 letters, but 3 of them are identical A's. They're non-distinguishable. You can't tell them apart. All right. And, oh, look, there's 2 N's as well. So how are we going to allow for that? Well, you know what? If they were all different letters, well, then there'd be what? FCP, there'd be 6 times 5 times 4 times 3. There'd be 6 factorial ways to rearrange them if they were all different. But they're not all different. We have 3 A's and there's two n's. And of course, if you have three somethings, there's three factorial or six ways to juggle them around. So we have to allow for the fact that there's six ways, three factorial ways to juggle around the a's, and there's two factorial ways to juggle around the n's. And don't forget, if you're going to divide, if you're going to have a divisor that is not just a single number, it's an expression, you need to put brackets around the entire divisor. And by the way, some calculators you got to put the times in here, and some calculators you don't. All right, so I would suggest you just always put the times in here. Sometimes I don't write it that way, but I would suggest you always put the times in there. Some calculators handle it, some calculators don't. So take the lowest common effect there. So it's going to be 720 divided by 12, 60 different ways to rearrange the letters in banana. Banana. All right, so yeah, if you wanted, you could clip out the letters and do it yourself for sure. Hey, this would be a good example for your cheat sheet, wouldn't it? Yeah, maybe you like this example for your cheat sheet. Odds, all right? Let's do the odds of an event happening. So if the odds of something happening are 75 out of every 100, right, then that would be the same as 3 out of 4 if you reduce it. So the odds in favor of something happening is, let's see, it happens 3 times and we tried 4 times. So if it happens 3 times and we tried 4 times, doesn't that mean at one time it was not favorable? So you'd say the odds in favor of something happening are 3 to 1, because 3 plus 1 makes 4 times that you tried. That's pretty basic, right? There we go. Oh, man, here we go again. I think this is like about the 10th time I've done this, all right? If you've been with me since grade 10, this will be the 10th time we've done this, all right? So how do you think? I don't know, all right? So let's pretend we got... Let's pretend we've got 7 people, and we'll give them names. Albert, Bruce, Carl, Dave, Elijah, Francis, and Gail, all right? So how many different ways can they shake hands, all right? So let's see. I'm going to draw them. I'm drawing their positions. They're standing in a circle, maybe, and so A is going to go shake hands with B. And then A is going to shake hands with C, and well, let's draw it, all right? So here we go. Are you ready? Here we go. There we go. So let's see. Draw. Drawing things is a wonderful way to organize your thoughts and see patterns and maybe even come up with a formula. All right. So watch this. How do you think? I don't know. This isn't the way to do it. There's 10 ways to do this. How do you think? All right. So A wanders over and shakes everybody's hand. So there's 7 people. So he doesn't shake his own hand. So he shakes with 6 people. Boom. And then B. Well, B's already shaken hands with A, so he doesn't have to go shake A's hand. So B only has to shake with 5 people. All right? So far it was 6 people and then 5. And now C wanders over, and C has already shaken with B, and he's already shaken with A, so we're not going to do it again. So that's going to be 5. Are you counting them? So A got to shake with 6, B got to shake with 5, C got to shake with 4. Can you see a pattern? Can you see a pattern? All right, 3, 2, 1, oh my God. So did you count as I was doing that? Right, count all the different, looks like a Dreamweaver, doesn't it? Oh, wow. Hey, when you add all that up, that's 21, all right? And you know how to add up consecutive numbers, it's 21, all right? So there's going to be 21, there's one way to think about it. And if you saw a formula, some of you see the formula. A couple of you use the formula now, right? If you wanted to get fancy, you could say, well, there was N people, 7, and 7 people can shake with 6 people because you got to take away 1. So there'd be 7 times 6 all divided by 2, which is 21. So that really just becomes a formula if you know how to think that way, or you could just count the lines here, or you could see the pattern here, or maybe you want to do a table. I don't know how you think, you know, but, you know, come up with some way to solve this stuff, right? It might take you, 5 minutes, all right? You might want to think 5 different ways. All right, so you could go like this. Why am I Xing out that? Because A, you don't shake your own hand, do you? So B doesn't shake with B. All right, so let's see. A shakes with B, A shakes with C, A shakes with D, and E and F and G. There we go. Now guess what? A and B have already shaken. So B's not going to wander over to A and say, hey, let's shake, buddy, because they already shook. So that one's going to be a big red X. And then B still has to go shake other people's hands. And can you see the pattern here? You'll figure it out, right? But guess what? There's a third or fourth way to figure it out, all right? And there's another dozen ways to do it as well, all right? Turns out the combo button on your calculator does it too. Oh, my goodness. Okay. Anyway. There. So, have you another way to do it? I don't. Oh, and by the way, I neglected to tell you here, but all you really had to do was go 7 combo 2. And that would tell you the answer was 21, right? Pretend I didn't show you that. All right. There we go. Bonus. All right, let's line up people. Let's do some fundamental counting. So we're unrestricted. There's no constraints here. We're just going to line up 5 people in a line and say, there, stand in a line and we'll take your picture. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, that's 5 factorial or 5 permute 5 because it's an ordered arrangement of 5 things and you're arranging all 5 of them and they're different objects. 120 ways. So there you go. Now, how many ways can we do if it's boy, girl, boy, girl? Well, let's see. There's only one possible arrangement there. It's got to be a boy, girl, boy, because there's 3 boys, 2 girls. So you go, let's see, 3 boys. So 3 chances there, 2 possibilities there, 1 there. And then the girls are 2 there and 1 there. So its possibilities are going to add up to 12 ways. So there's 12 ways to do that, alternating boy, girl, boy, girl, boy. Or you could just make a list. There's not that many. You could make a list of all of them if you wanted. That's a lot of work. Let's do C. How many ways could we line up if the 2 tallest boys have to be at either end? All right, so let's see. We got to have a tall boy here and a tall boy there. So how many tall boys are there? Well, I didn't say which end they were going to go at, right? So how many choices for that tall boy? 2 choices. And how many choices for that tall boy? Right? 1 choice. Right? Because he's the next tallest boy. Right, so there's your tallest, one of your 2 tallest boys is there, put it that way. And then your next tallest boy, in other words, one last chance is that guy. Which means that then there's 3 possibilities, 2 possibilities, 1 possibility. So there's the answer I get if we didn't have to keep the boy-girl-boy-girl arrangement. Now what if you had to keep the boy-girl-boy-girl arrangement? See, the question wasn't very clear, was it? But that's what happens sometimes. Sometimes questions aren't clear. You just go with it, all right? Or you ask, what do you mean? All right, that's part of solving a problem is getting clarification. So if we had to be boy, girl, boy, girl, so the boy, there was 2 possibilities for a tall boy there, 1 possibility for a tall boy there. Then here, this had to be a boy. So there's only 1 boy left over because we've got 1 there and 1 there. And then this has to be a girl, 2 choices. So it works out there's only 4 ways to do it. If you had to have the 2 tallest boys on the outside and then alternating boy, girl. So isn't counting fun? Oh, my God. Well, we did a lot there. Wow, that's looking pretty good there, guys. Anyway, there we go. Load clear. Determined to deliver, baby.